بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا وحبيبنا وقدوتنا وقائدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما أخرجنا من ظلمات الوهم وأكرمنا بنور الفهم وأنعم علينا يا عظيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قول أما بعد. All praise due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and peace be upon his beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I testify that there is no God except Allah Almighty and I testify that Muhammad is the Prophet and the Messenger of Allah. Brothers and sisters, I ask Allah Azza wa Jal, the one that he gathers us at his house to make us from amongst those who he gathers under the banner of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam and under his shade when there's no shade except his shade in the hereafter. Today's topic is a continued topic or a topic that we continue on our previous topics in the past few weeks in which we've been talking about the signs of the Day of Judgment. And I began talking about the minor signs and I covered over 60 minor signs from the authentic narrations that our scholars had authenticated. And I do mention to you again that on this topic you find a lot of fabricated ahadith, in particular today's topic. And today inshaAllah we're going to talk about the major minor sign, which is the minor major sign. And it is the beginning of the major signs. And that's the arrival of the Mahdi. But before I talk into and begin my speech onto the into the arrival of the Mahdi, I want to mention one or two minor signs before that some of them already happened and some of them are connected to the arrival or the advent of the Mahdi. Last week we spoke about other minor signs. And I also mentioned two minor signs though that would not take place until later on, or maybe even after the major signs. And remember what I mentioned to you before, that it's not necessarily that all the minor signs come before the major signs, but there are minor signs that will take place during the major signs, and there are minor signs that will take place after the major signs. Such as what I mentioned to you last week about Al-Madinah and Mecca, where the end of Medina will come and the end of the Kaaba will come, and there'll be no longer people going or no longer people visiting Medina or visiting Mecca because it will be more like abolished. And also one of the minor signs that I did not mention that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam spoke about, and this shows the knowledge that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to receive from Allah azza wa jalla, how precise it is. And there's no way that someone like Muhammad from Mecca in the middle of the Arabian Peninsula come up with so precise information. That he speaks about one of the signs of the Day of Judgment and what's happening in the future. Where did Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam get this information from? And so precise. Obviously, there's no answer except that it came from Allah. One of them is the fighting of the Turks. The Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says that the Day of Judgment would not take place until the Muslims fight against the Turks. Until the Muslims fight against the Turks. But it doesn't stop here. In Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam goes into details who the Turks are and how they look. And you know what? I assure you, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam never met a Turk before. And you know what? They would not even call Turks at that time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Turks originate from Mongolia. And that did not happen only till after the time of the Prophet ﷺ, and years and centuries after the Prophet ﷺ, where they were called Turks. But Nabi ﷺ named them with the exact name and the name of their tribes and their race, even though that name within itself did not even exist during the time of the Prophet ﷺ. He says ﷺ, the Day of Judgment would not take place until the Muslims fight against the Turks. And obviously here, we're talking about the Turks before Islam, not after Islam. And we are talking about the Turks that come from the original race, which is from Mongolia. That's where most of the Turks come from, Central Asia. In Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, "They are a tribe. Their faces is like a flat shield. Their faces is like a flat shield." A description of a white face. A very white face. Like a flat shield. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also describes their noses. Alayhi salatu wa sallam describes their noses flat. And when you look into the description of the Mongolians, their faces are wide and their noses are flat. But this is the amazing part comes in. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, their garments, their clothes, from hair. And their shoes is from hair. When you look at the people who live in Central Asia, or those, the Russians, those who live in cold areas, what do they wear? They wear very, very, you know, very, very heavy clothes made out of wool. But it looks like hair to the Prophet ﷺ and the Sahaba. They had no name to it. In Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, their garments are made out of hair. And their shoes are made out of hair. And I assure you, in Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, probably never, ever, ever met someone during his time that was wearing type of clothes. Who is that in Mecca or in the Arabian Peninsula? It's too hot. It's too hot to wear that type of clothes. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shows the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam their appearance and even their garments. And yes, when the Mongolians and the Tatars came into the Muslim world and they invaded Iraq and went through Syria until they reached to Palestine, and that's when they were defeated and then they became Muslims. When the Muslims first had their first encounter with the Mongolians and the Tatars, it is exactly how the Prophet ﷺ described them. But you know when this took place? It took place 600 years after the Prophet ﷺ. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the day of judgment would not take place until the Muslims fought against the Turks. Flat faces like a flat shield, flat nose. Their clothes are made out of hair and their shoes is made out of hair. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He also alayhi salatu wa sallam, he says that the day of judgment would not take place until you fight the Ajam. Until you fight the Ajam. Who are the Ajam? They are the non-Arabs. And mainly they used to refer to the Eastern people as the Ajam. The Persians, the Russians, the Asians. And the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam also describes their noses are flat and their eyes are tiny. Not disgracing or discriminating, but our Asian brothers and sisters or the Chinese, their eyes, in comparison to the Arabs, it's tiny compared to the Arabs. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, "Sigar al-ayun," their eyes are tiny. Where did the Prophet ﷺ get that description from? Where did the Prophet ﷺ get that description from? Their faces like a flat shield, white, very white faces. And when you look, subhanallah, it is exactly how the Prophet ﷺ described them. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also says that the day of judgment would not come until the Muslims conquer Constantinople. Constantinople. The day of judgment would not come until the Muslims conquer Constantinople. The famous city Constantinople is what's known these days as Istanbul. Half of it is in Asia, the other half is in Europe. And it was a very strong hold for the Romans. The Romans are those who used to rule most of Europe during the time of the Prophet ﷺ. And you hear the Prophet ﷺ constantly refer Romans, Romans, Romans. When the Prophet ﷺ refers to Romans, he refers to the Europeans. And the Arabs used to also call them Bani al-Asfar, the people of the yellow, or the yellow people. The yellow people. In Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he says the day of judgment will not take place until you open and conquer Constantinople. Which Constantinople are we referring to? Constantinople, the one that's previously called Constantinople and now called Istanbul, which the Muslims conquered Constantinople a few centuries ago? No. In Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam is not referring to Istanbul. That's already taken place. In Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam is referring to Roman Italy. The headquarters and the capital of the Romans at that time. Constantinople was one of them, and Rome is the major one. In Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he says, have you heard of a city, half of it is on land and the other half is in the ocean? So they said, yes, O Messenger of Allah. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, the day of judgment would not take place until 70,000 people from the progeny and the tribe of Bani Ishaq, referring to Ishaq, the son of Ibrahim. And Bani Ishaq here are the Romans. Here, indication that there will be a large number of Europeans who will embrace Islam. And then they'll fight for Islam and the Muslims. And then they'll fight their own people to uphold Islam. Banu Ishaq. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, the day of judgment would not take place until 70,000 people from the children and the progeny of Ishaq, who are Europeans that became Muslims, they will go to Constantinople, that land that's half into the sea and half into or on land. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, when they arrive it, they will conquer it without any fighting, without even drawing the sword. Alayhi salatu wasalam, he says, thou will open it by the takbir and the tahleel. La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar. That's all they say. They do not, take out any weapon. In Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasalam, he says, Allah will open that city on their hands by La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar. He says, alayhi salatu wasalam, he says, the first time they will say, La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar, its part in the sea will fall. Its part, its construction on the sea will fall. Then the second time they will say, La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar, its part on land will fall. And then the third time they say, La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar, its gates and fortress will fall, so the Muslims will conquer it. In Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, so precise. He says, alayhi salatu wasalam, you'll fight against the Persians, and Allah Azza wa Jalla will give you victory against them. Then you'll fight against the Romans, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you victory over them. And then you'll fight for Constantinople and conquer Constantinople, and Allah Azza wa Jalla will conquer it for you. And then you'll fight the Dajjal. See here, the opening of Constantinople and Rome is connected to the arrival of the Dajjal. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as Allah informs him, first, you'll open the Arabian Peninsula, then you'll open Persia, then you'll open Rome, Constantinople, and then you'll fight against the Dajjal. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you victory against him. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is precise. First of all, the Arabian Peninsula, then Persia, then Rome, then after that, the Dajjal. Our main topic today is about the Mahdi, because all these events are connected to the Mahdi. And the ahadith that we talk about today, even with regards of the opening of Constantinople, Rome, it is during the time of the Mahdi. And I remind you of a hadith that I began When I spoke about the minor signs of the Day of Judgment, in Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells Auf ibn Malik, the Day of Judgment will not take place until you see six things. Six things you must see before the Day of Judgment comes. Before the beginning of the Day of Judgment, you must experience six things. And then Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam speaks about, first of all, my death. The Day of Judgment will not come until I die. The opening of Jerusalem. And an illness that will come and make people fall like a herd, or illness that hits a herd, and the entire herd falls dead. And wealth will be so spread, widespread amongst people, that people don't know what to do with it anymore. And a fitna that will enter the house of every Arab. I mentioned that to you. The sixth one I said, I'll leave it to this time. In Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, and a treaty, a peace treaty, between the Muslims and Bani al-Asfar, the yellow people. Who are the yellow people? The Romans. Who are the Romans these days? The Europeans. And you could also include the Americans. In Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, the Day of Judgment will not take place until you see six things. The sixth one that the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam mentions, he says there will be a peace treaty between the Muslims and the yellow people, or the yellow tribe. Who are the Europeans? The Romans. Together, the Muslims and the Europeans, they'll fight a common enemy. Muslims and the Europeans. And when you say Europeans, you refer to more as Christians. The Muslims and the Christians will have a peace treaty. And they'll fight a common enemy. Who's that common enemy? Allahu A'lam. Some scholars, you know, say it's the Russians and the Asians and the Chinese. Allahu A'lam, it could be anyone. Other scholars say it is the Jews. Allahu A'lam. In Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, a peace treaty between the Muslims and the Europeans, the Romans. They'll fight a common enemy. Then what happens? The Romans will break the treaty. So now you've got the Muslims and the Christians from the Europeans. There's a peace treaty between them. They'll fight a common enemy. And they'll be victorious. They'll win the war. Then the Europeans or the Romans will break the treaty. Then in Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, they will mobilize their army, the Europeans, and come and fight against the Muslims under 80 banners, every banner 12,000 soldiers under it. Total 960,000 soldiers. Look how precise the Prophet ﷺ says. After the Europeans break the treaty, a war will break out between the Muslims and the Europeans. Before that, the Muslims and the Europeans are united against a common enemy. They'll win. After the victory, and the Prophet ﷺ even says in a very precise, he says, after the Muslims and the Europeans, who they have a peace treaty between them, after they win the war against their common enemy, one Christian or crusader will carry the cross, and he says, because of that, we were victorious. So the Muslim says, no, because of Allah, we were victorious. So they'll fight one another. In Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, then the Romans, the Europeans, will gather and assemble an army of 80 banners, under every banner 12,000 soldiers. 80 times 12,000 is 960,000 soldiers. That's about 1 million soldiers. In Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, another hadith, he says, the Day of Judgment will not take place until the Romans are the largest population in the world. Who will be the largest in population in this world? The Romans, which are the Europeans. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, the Day of Judgment will not take place until the Romans are the most populated people on the surface of this earth. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam even tells us the details of this war, how amazing this war is. And this is during the time of the Mahdi. There is nothing 100% that says the Mahdi is there, But this is the analyzation of the scholars connecting the ahadith together, and they say this is the time of the Mahdi. And the Muslims will be led by the Mahdi at that time. The Muslims will be led by the Mahdi at that time. Because during the time of the Mahdi is the time that the Dajjal comes. And during the time of the Dajjal is the time that Isa alayhi salam comes. So the Mahdi will experience the Dajjal and he'll experience Isa alayhi salam. And he'll be the final Khalifa or one of the last Khulafa that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send on the surface of this earth. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, the prophecy will be amongst you as long as Allah azza wa jalla keeps it. He's saying to the Sahaba, him, as the last and the final prophet. The prophecy is amongst you until Allah azza wa jalla takes it away. Then after it, in Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying to us, how this world will go through different stages. After the prophecy, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, there will be a khilafah according to the way of the prophecy. He was that? Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali. They led and ruled by the way of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. In Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes it, until Allah removes it. After that phase, the third phase, in Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, mulkan aadan, a very bitter kingship, tough, rough kingship. The Muslims will be led, the Muslims will be ruled by very aggressive and ruthless kings. And that happened. The fourth phase in Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, after that, the Muslims will be led by mulkan jabriya, an oppressive kingship. The first phase is the prophecy. Second phase, khilafah according to the prophecy. Third phase, a beating, rough, tough kingship. The fourth phase is an oppressive kingship, a dictating kingship, a military kingship. The Muslims will be ruled by the militants, by the soldiers, and that's what you see around the world. 90% of the Muslim countries are led and ruled by the military. But then, what's the fifth phase? And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, after that, we'll go back to a khilafah according to the way of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. After that, takunu khilafatan ala minhaj al-nubuwa. After that, will be khilafah according to the way of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It began with the prophecy, then khilafah according to the way of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then a beating kingship, then a military kingship, then it goes back to the way of the khilafah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, referring to the time of the Mahdi. And some scholars say it is also possible before the time of the Mahdi. It is also possible before the time of the Mahdi. In Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, if there's only one day left to this world before it ends, Allah Azza wa Jalla will leave that day to send a man from my progeny, from my descent, from my lineage. His name is my name. His father's name is my father's name. Allah Azza wa Jalla will spread justice and peace on his hands the way this world was occupied with injustice and oppression. The Mahdi, yes, the Mahdi will come. And the Mahdi is from the progeny of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And his name is Muhammad. And his father's name is Abdullah. And he descends from who? From Al-Hasan, the son of who? Ali. The husband of who? Fatima. The daughter of who? Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he is Muhammad ibn Abdullah al-Hasani al-Alawi to Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, al-Fatimi from Fatima radiallahu ta'ala anha, al-Qurashi from the tribe of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This man, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send him to lead this ummah. As the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, if there is one day left, if there is one day left for this dunya, Allah will keep this day for a man from my descent, from my progeny. That Allah will send him who ruled this ummah, lead this ummah, and bring justice and peace to them the way they faced oppression and injustice. And amongst the wars that he'll lead is that great malhama, that great epic. In Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is so precise. In Nabi alayhi salatu wa sallam is so precise that he says in the famous hadith, the day of judgment will not take place until the Muslims fight against the Romans. He doesn't stop here. He even says where the war will take place. In Nabi alayhi salatu wa sallam, he says, the day of judgment would not take place until the Muslims fought against the Romans. That's after what? After the Muslims had a peace treaty with the Romans and they fought against a common enemy. Now they'll fight one another. Where do they fight one another? In Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, not only he tells us the country, but even the city and the town. In Dabiq, A'maq wa Dabiq, north of Syria, 45 kilometers from Aleppo, 15 kilometers close to the Turkish borders. In Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, the day of judgment will not take place until the Muslims fight against the Romans. Where, ya messenger? Where, O messenger of Allah? In A'maq and Dabiq. Where's A'maq and Dabiq? North of Syria, between Aleppo, Halab, and the Turkish borders. 15 kilometers from the Turkish borders and 45 kilometers from Aleppo. Those two cities and towns did not even exist during the time of the Prophet ﷺ. And Nabi ﷺ names it. He says, alayhi salatu wasalam, the day of judgment would not take place until the Muslims fight against the Romans. Where? In Dabiq and A'maq. He says, alayhi salatu wasalam, an army will come out of Medina. The Muslim army will come out of where? Medina. In Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, they are the best of people standing on the surface of this earth at that time. The army, the Muslim army will come out of Medina to face and fight the Roman army. Where? In Dabiq. In Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, they are the best of people and horsemen standing on the surface of this earth at that time. He says, alayhi salatu wasalam, when the Muslims and the Romans deploy their armies and they line up their armies and face one another, the Romans will call upon the Muslims and say to them, let our own kind, from our own people, from our own color and skin, take them out of your army so we could fight them. Indication that there will be a lot of Romans, Europeans who are Muslims, who are in the Muslim army. So the Romans will say, where's the people from our kind? We want to fight them. Those who left us and betrayed us, we want to fight them first. So the Muslims will reply back and say, La wallah, no by Allah, no by Allah. We never ever let go of our own brothers. They are brothers. We don't look at them, Europeans or non-Europeans. They are brothers, they are Muslims. La wallah, by Allah, we'll never let go or betray our own brothers. So they'll fight one another. They will fight one another. In Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, a third of the Muslim army will be defeated. Not only that, in Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Allah would not even accept their repentance. Some of the scholars interpret that as, they apostate Islam. When they see the large number of the Roman army and how big they are and how powerful they are and the number of their soldiers and their, you know, and the number of their armies, a third will get scared and apostate Islam. Allah does not even accept their repentance. The second third, in Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, they will fight till death. They are the best of martyrs and shuhada. The second third, they'll fight till death. They are the best of shuhada and martyrs to Allah Azza wa Jal. And the last third, the third third, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give them victory on their hands. Allah will give victory on the last third that stays firm and strong. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give them victory against the Romans. How precise the details of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. The first third of the Muslim army, they leave Islam from the fear. They become with the non-Muslims, as some scholars interpret that. Allah would never accept their repentance, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam says. The second third, they die, they fight till death. They are the best of shuhada. The third third, in Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, Allah will open and give victory to them. Then, in Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he says, after the Muslims defeat the Romans, the Europeans, they will then go towards Rome. And then they'll conquer Rome. After the Muslims defeat the Europeans or the Romans, they will go towards Rome and conquer Rome. In Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he says, while the Muslims are celebrating victory and they've hanged their swords on the olive trees. Look at the precise information. Olive trees. And we know Rome is one of the largest producing olives in the world. While the Muslims are celebrating victory and they've hanged their swords where? On the olive trees. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam didn't say any tree, on the olive trees. And dividing the booty amongst them, I will call and say, the Dajjal had arrived and he's attacking your people back in Sham. People have families, these soldiers have families. They've left their families behind, their wives, their kids, their mothers, the elderly. While they are celebrating victory in Rome, the victory that Allah Azza wa Jalla had promised, a caller will call. Another hadith in Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says it will be the shaitan. He wanted to distract them and say that the Dajjal had arrived and he's aiming for your people. Look what the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says. He says, the Muslim army will decide to send 10 horsemen, 10 great Muslim soldiers, horsemen. In Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, they are from the best of believers standing on the surface of this earth. But that's not the amazing part. The amazing part in Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, by Allah, those 10, I know their names. I know the names of their fathers. I know the color of their horses. It's like Al Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's got the full report. They are the best of horsemen standing on the surface of this earth at that time. They'll go and investigate. Is it true? What they've heard that the Dajjal had arrived and is attacking and aiming for their people. This is in one hadith. And then Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he says, at that time, Isa Alayhi Salam will come. Isa alayhi salam will come. He'll come while the Muslims are preparing themselves to fight against the Dajjal. Isa alayhi salam will arrive. And I'll mention to you inshallah in the upcoming lessons how Isa alayhi salam will arrive and where he'll arrive and when he'll arrive. Not with time, with events. Isa alayhi salam will arrive. And Isa alayhi salam will arrive and he'll descend down. Allah Azza wa Jalla will send him down while the Muslim army are prepared to attack the Dajjal. While the Muslims are prepared to attack the Dajjal. Who are they led by? By the Amir, and Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam describes him. Amir, their leader. Majority of the scholars say the Amir is the Mahdi. The Amir is the Mahdi. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam even says when he arrives, when Isa arrives and meets the Muslim army, while the Muslims are prepared to pray Salat al-Fajr in al-Quds. The Muslim army led by the Mahdi are prepared to fight against, or they are preparing to fight against the Dajjal. At that moment, they are getting ready to pray Salat al-Fajr. So who comes? Isa. Isa alayhi salam, the one that Allah promised that he'll return. What does the Mahdi do? Isa. Who am I to lead the praise when Isa is here? So the Amir, the leader of the Muslim army at that time, the Mahdi, who say to Isa, or Isa, you lead the praise. You lead the praise. You're a prophet. I'm not just a normal human being. You're a prophet. There's no doubt you are better than me. So you know what Isa says? He says, no, 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 no. You are leaders over each other. You are leaders over one another. And this salah, this iqamah, was made for you as a respect and honor to this nation. The nation of who? Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He says, no, you lead the prayer. The iqamah was made for you, and you are leaders over one another as a respect and honor to this nation, the nation of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Amazing. Amazing. How precise the details of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasallam. In another hadith, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, one of the great companions that accompanied the Prophet alayhi salatu wasallam for a very long time, and he was from the early comers into Islam. He was in Kufa, one of the cities in Iraq after the death of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasallam. One day, while he was sleeping or having a short nap, a quick nap, a big, strong storm came into Kufa. So one of the men, he said, the day of judgment had came, the day of judgment had came. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, wake up. What's going on here? The day of judgment, it looks like it's the day of judgment. Look what's happening in this world. So Abdullah says, relax, relax, relax. The day of judgment would not come until there's no one to take the inheritance and there's no one to be happy over the booty. The day of judgment would not come until inheritance is not divided because there's no one to take it. And there is a lot of booty, but no one is happy about it because there's not many people who are alive. Then he talks. He says it begins from there. And he points towards Syria, Ash-Sham. He says the day of judgment will begin from there. And he points towards Ash-Sham. And then he says, an enemy that will mobilize themselves to fight against the Muslims. So they said, who do you refer to? Are you referring to the Romans? He said, yes. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud is saying, yes, I refer to the Romans. And obviously this information, where did Abdullah ibn Mas'ud get it from? From his beloved teacher Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And then he says, and there will be a very severe and tough fight, a war between the Muslims and the Romans. Will be so powerful, so rough, so harsh, that if a bird flies from above it, will fall dead. That's what Abdullah ibn Mas'ud says. And then he says, at that moment, a group of Muslims will put a condition upon themselves, they'll continue fighting until victory. So they'll fight that first day, and they'll fight and continue to fight with bravery and courage never experienced before. This is what the hadith says. Never ever been experienced before. So brave, so courageous, never seen before. Nothing stops them until the night comes. So they rest. The next day comes in, they all make a promise amongst them that we'll fight until victory. So they continue fighting and fighting and fighting with full bravery and courage never seen before. So tough. A war never existed in the past. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam saying that. These are the words of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, which only says what he heard from the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Never existed in the past. So tough, so big, so rough. Until the night comes and separates between the two. The third day comes in, so the Muslims will get together and make an oath and a promise that we'll fight until victory. So they'll fight and continue fighting and fight and continue fighting with full bravery and courage. Nothing stops them until the night. Until the fourth day comes in with a minority number of Muslims. The last 3 days, a lot of Muslims fell dead. A lot of Muslims died. The fourth day, there'll be a small number of believers. On the fourth day, they'll make an oath that today is the day of victory. And we'll continue fighting until we obtain victory. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, they'll fight a fight never ever seen before. Lam yura mithlaha. A fight and a battle never seen ever before. That even if a bird will go above them, it will fall die, it will fall dead, until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives them victory. So when do they get victory? On the fourth day, after many Muslims had died. Then Abdullah ibn Mas'ud interprets what he said, the day of judgment will not come until there is no inheritance to be divided and no booty or spoils to be happy about. He says when the Muslims obtain victory on the fourth day, out of every 100 in one tribe, one will stay alive. A tribe of 100 people. A tribe of 100 people participate into this battle, they will all fall dead except one. So this man, this one person, who's going to inherit him? His only one, his brothers, his uncles, his children, his nephews, they all died in the battle. Only one will stay alive. And all the spoils, be happy for what? Be happy over the spoils, or not enough people from your tribe had died. Obviously, you're happy for the shahada, but people get sad and upset. This is also relating to the war against the Romans, the Europeans, as the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says. And then after that will be the opening of Constantinople, which is Rome. And then after that will come the Dajjal. And Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says, the day of judgment will not take place until you conquer the Arabian Peninsula, and Allah will open it for you. Then you conquer Persia, and Allah will open it for you. Then you conquer Rome and Constantinople, and Allah will open it for you. Then what comes after it? The Dajjal. You'll fight against the Dajjal, and Allah Azza wa Jalla will defeat him for you. The Mahdi. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says that the day of judgment will not take place until Allah sends a man from my descent, from my progeny. His name is my name. His father's name is my father's name. Even in Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam describes him. In Nabi alayhi salatu wa sallam, he says, ajla al-jabha. He has a broad, clear forehead. Here, not much hair at the front. Very broad and clear forehead. Aqna al-anf. Prominent nose. Like high up a bit. Tiny and high up a bit. Describes him, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then in Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, he will spread this world justice and peace after it was filled up with injustice and oppression. Then he says, and he'll stay here for 7 years. Another hadith, 8 years. Another hadith, 9 years. So his stay, his rulership, his leadership will last between 7 to 9 years. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says something amazing about this character. You are talking about a very strong character, a very brave character, a very wise character, a very smart character. Al-Mahdi is a very wise, smart, religious, pious, brave, courageous character. You know all these characteristics of a good leader? It does not exist in him until the day and the night Allah decides or decrees upon him that he becomes the Mahdi. In Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says in this amazing hadith, يُصْلِحُهُ اللَّهُ فِي لَيْلَةٍ. Within one night, Allah will change his character from being maybe an average or weak character into a strong and a powerful character. One night. So if you look around, who do you see as the Mahdi? He'll be the last one to be chosen. Yes? And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, it's on that night that Allah decrees for him to be declared the Mahdi, is that night that Allah Azza wa Jalla changes his character. His character changes from being the average, simple, humble man into a leader, into braveness and courage, smart, wise. All this happens in one night. So he's not someone that he's prepared for it. Allah prepares him in one night. يُصْلِحُ اللَّهُ فِي لَيْلَةٍ. When he comes, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says that this world will be filled up with oppression and injustice. When he comes, he will fill up this world with justice and peace. And not only that, but in Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will let the rain come down and the ground to produce its production. Even in Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says how prosperous and fruitful his time will be. He'll have so much money, he'll give it out, and he doesn't even count it. In Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, he gives out the money like with a handful, take, 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 and it doesn't count. He doesn't say, okay, we gave you 100. How much he gave him? 1,000. You know, Centrelink 3.9 and 50 cents or 21 cents. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, he gives out the money. He gives it out in large amounts. He doesn't even count it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make his time a time of prosperity, a time of justice and peace. Even in Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, the moment that he comes out, indication when he comes out, he comes out during a moment with three brothers, a children that are the children and the sons of a Khalifa. That's why the scholars say there could be Khilafah before the Mahdi. Three brothers belong to one father, Khalifa. After the death of their father, they'll fight over his kingdom. After the death of their father, they'll fight over the kingdom of their father. One will kill the other two. And they'll fight over treasure under the Kaaba. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, they'll fight over treasure under the Kaaba. At that moment, the family of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will be oppressed. And he is from the family of the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam, the Mahdi. In Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he describes, he will escape from Medina to Mecca. He will escape from Medina to Mecca from the oppression that the leader at that time will put upon the family of the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam. In Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam describes him as a refugee that resorts to Allah azza wa jal in Mecca. A'id al-bayt. Someone who escape from Medina to Mecca seeking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's protection. And he resorts to Allah. And where is he? He's in Mecca. In Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, people will recognize him. And the scholars tell us who are these people that recognize him. The scholars, the righteous scholars with knowledge, they recognize this man looks like something about him. So what do? They force him to give him bay'ah. You are the Mahdi. There are some signs that Allah is putting in our hearts. Say, you are the Mahdi. We want to give you pledge. Yukra, he will be compelled. He doesn't stand up and say, oh people, I am the Mahdi. The moment someone does that, know that he's a liar. Alhamdulillah. That's the first sign. He does not stand up and say, I am the Mahdi. He'll be compelled, he'll be forced to be given the bay'ah. He'll refuse. In some ahadith says, he'll refuse. And then he'll come back again, and then he'll be forced to be given the bay'ah. That's when he accepts, and that's where the scholars and the righteous people will surround him. Not everyone, the scholars and the righteous people will surround him. The second sign, which is amazing, an army that will come from the east, a Muslim army that will come from the east carrying black flags and banners, that will come not to fight with him, to fight against him. Fight against who? The Mahdi. A Muslim army will come and fight against the Mahdi. Not non-Muslims. A Muslim army with black banners and flags will come from the east to fight against the Mahdi. On their way from Medina to Mecca, Allah will collapse the ground under them and swallow them. That's the other sign. When the Mahdi is given bay'ah to, and the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam even tells us where he'll be given the bay'ah to, between Hajar al-Aswad and Maqam Ibrahim. Between Hajar al-Aswad and Maqam Ibrahim, that's where he'll be given the bay'ah. Then the news starts to spread that there is the Mahdi. So a Muslim army will come from the east with black flags, as the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam says, when they are in the middle of the desert between Medina and Mecca, the ground will swallow them, will collapse and swallow them. That's another sign that he is the Mahdi. One day, Aisha says, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had a sleepless night. He had a sleepless night, moving all night, waking up, going to sleep. So Aisha said, oh Messenger of Allah, I've never seen you have a sleepless night like this before. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, yes, I'm amazed that people from my nation will mobilize an army to fight someone from my nation, from my progeny. I'm amazed that people from my nation will gather together and fight someone from my family, from Quraysh. Until they arrive in the middle of the desert will collapse and swallow them. So she said, oh Messenger of Allah, everyone? And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, everyone. So she said, oh Messenger of Allah, all of them are bad? And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, no. Some came out with the army intentionally to fight against the Mahdi. They are the people of the hellfire. Others, we're not sure, they just followed. Allah will bring him back in the hereafter according to their intention. Others were forced to be in the army. Others were forced to be in the army. So Allah Azza wa Jalla will look at their intention. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will look at their intention. They'll all die their one death. They'll all die one death, but will be resurrected with different intentions. Some will go to the Jannah, others will go to the hellfire. That's another sign about the Mahdi. That once he comes out, a Muslim army will be mobilized and assembled to fight him. On their way from Medina to Mecca, in the middle of the desert will collapse and swallow them. All of them. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, only few will stay alive. They will tell the rest about what happened. Rabbaka kabir, Allah's great. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he says, there'll continue to be a gang and a group from my nation fighting for the haqq, fi no one but Allah, until Isa alayhi salam comes. So the Amir will say to Isa, you pray. So Isa will say, no, inna ba'dakum ala ba'dan umara, you are leaders over one another, takrimatan lillahi lihadihi al-umma, an honor from Allah Azza wa Jalla to this ummah. In Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also describes to us that the Mahdi will be forced. This is important. He'll be forced, compelled to take the bay'ah. And it will be in Mecca, between Hajar al-Aswad and the Maqam. And the ones who recognize him are who? The scholars and the pious, righteous Muslims. Then the news will start spreading out. Then a Muslim army will come to fight against him. So Allah Azza wa Jal will make the ground swallow him, swallow them. Then another Muslim army will come and fight with him. So the first Muslim army will come with black banners, fighting against the Mahdi. Allah will destroy them. Allah will make the ground in the middle of the desert to swallow them. Collapse. Then after that, the news will be widespread. Everyone will be hearing about it. And everyone will confirm the signs. So another Muslim army will be mobilized and assembled around him, fighting for him under black banners. Ikhwani, wallahi, it's scary. It's scary. Which army are you going to be in if you live at that time? It's scary. That's why the scholars taught us one thing. Don't wish you at that time. Don't say, oh, I'm not going to do anything until the Mahdi comes. Oh, this ummah, this ummah, that. You don't know when that time comes, who you're going to be with. You don't know at that time when it comes, who you're going to stand with. This is fitan, these tests. These are the times of tests. These are the times of hardships. These are the times of afflictions. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam tells us about the Mahdi. And the word Mahdi in Arabic means the guided one. The guided one. His name is Muhammad. His father's name is Abdullah. His descent and lineage comes from where? From Fatima. Through her son Al-Hasan. From her husband Ali, her father Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasallam says in another hadith, the khilafah is in Quraysh. The people of Quraysh have more rights over them leading this ummah than anyone else. If they are righteous, of course. If they are righteous. And the Mahdi will stay leading between 7 to 9 years. During that time, he'll meet Isa. During that time, he'll also see the Dajjal. And he'll die during the time of Isa. And he'll lead, Isa will lead the Muslim ummah. And Isa will stay for about 40 years. So the Mahdi will live. He will live and rule between 7 and 9 years, as the Prophet ﷺ says. And then he'll die. And the Muslims will bury him and they'll pray on him and bury him. And then the leadership of the Muslim ummah will be in the hands of Isa alayhi salam. So his leadership and rulership is only short. It's short, only between 7 to 9 years, as the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he says. The Mahdi will be born normal birth. And he will live normal living human being. We don't believe what others believe, that he's born from the time of Fatima and he's in some cave, only some scholars know about him and no one can see him. Especially the Shia say that. Mawjudun fil amsar, hada ghaib an al absar. Mawjudun fil amsar, ghaib an al absar. He exists, but no one can see him. Only some scholars from Iran and from Iraq, they go and visit him and they get instructions from him from the time of... No. Al-Mahdi will be born normal birth, from normal families, from normal mom and dad. Fatima didn't give birth to him, radiallahu ta'ala anha. He'll be born from normal parents. His father is from the progeny of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he's a normal human being. He lives, he goes to schools like everyone knows, he lives. He'll be the last one that you ever point and say, he is the Mahdi. Until that time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decrees that he becomes the Mahdi, Allah will change his character from being just an average person to the great leadership character. This is something important, inshallah, that I want to clarify. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from amongst those who listen and hear and act upon what they listen and hear. Inshallah, next talk about the connection between Mahdi and Isa. Because now we start talking about the major signs of the Day of Judgment, which is the arrival of Isa and Dajjal comes before Isa, and so on, inshallah. Ask Allah to make us from amongst those. You listen and hear, act upon what they listen here. Subhanakallahumma hamdika, nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.